I'll take it as a yes. Okay.
Yes, I'll be there.
Sorry. Okay, fantastic. Thank you very much. All right, so good evening, everyone, and welcome to the third edition of the Modern Languages Teaching Forum at the University of Kent. Hopefully I am unmuted. Yes, I am unmuted, that's great. I am delighted to see so many of you here, albeit, of course, only in virtual form. And as I said before the beginning of the meeting, it is incredible not only to see so many of you here, to see such a crowded room and such a quiet room too. Definitely something I'm not used to. But it's amazing. Thank you. Thank you very much for your overwhelming interest, for the interest that you have demonstrated in these initiatives. And thanks for taking the time to take part to what I think will be a very, very exciting and inspirational forum. Now, before we begin, a couple of service announcements. This is a big meeting. And as a matter of fact, it is definitely the biggest meeting I had the pleasure to be in. We expect in excess of 150 participants. So I will ask you to mute your microphone if you are not speaking, please, which most of you are already doing. And if not, I think Heide is taking care of that. Otherwise, we get a lot of feedback loops and strange sounds, especially from typing. You will have already seen the program, but this is just a reminder that we have five papers, five contributions. There is an unmuted microphone, I think. Well, we have five contributions, 10 minutes each. I will ask the speakers to respect the time limit, please, because otherwise it's very difficult to check the timing and everything. Each of these will be followed by 5 minutes discussion, and we will conclude the time left at the forum with a plenary discussion, and we can raise issues and see if we find any solution here. So may I suggest that for the discussion, we use the raise hand function in case you want to speak for longer, and to use the chat function for just quick questions and comments that I will keep an eye out on the chat, and I will read them aloud when there is a short interruption. And may I also remind you that, as you might have noticed at the beginning, the forum is being recorded and it will be made available on YouTube within the next couple of days. Now, a little bit of history, and don't worry, it's not a very long history, because the forum was born last year and was born in the Department of Modern Languages here at the University of Kent. What drove its creation was our desire to bridge the teaching and learning of modern foreign languages across education levels and across languages. And we called it a forum, not just because it is a fancy word, granted, especially in the plural, it's really fancy, the forum or the fora, but because we wanted to create a space, a proper space, where school and university teachers and researchers in modern languages can meet and openly discuss the challenges we are all facing. Of course, in order to face them together, but also to try and overcome them together by sharing the excellent practice that we, as teachers of modern foreign languages, are fostering throughout the world and across educational levels. The forum runs biannually. The first edition was dedicated to grammar tuition, and the second was dedicated to speaking. You can find the materials that we have produced and that were presented on our website, and I will link the website on the chat. When the time came, however, to organize the third edition, COVID-19 had just begun to force an increasing number of institutions to move their provision online. And it was only natural, therefore, that the forum should rise to the challenge to offer a platform where we could meet and share the woes and perhaps the delights, of course, of distance learning and teaching a modern foreign language. And well, never mind the social distancing has not been lifted, what better form of delivery of a distance learning forum than of course, a distance learning forum, a large-scale Zoom meeting. There are, of course, some silver lining to this whole COVID situation, and for our sector, there are not small ones. While we are forced by contingency to move our teaching provision online, at the same time, we discover new approaches to teaching and new ways of facing challenges together. It is a terrible crisis, but we have to make the most of it and consider the opportunities that this is opening up. And this forum is the perfect example of one such opportunity. While we had no choice but to move it online, because of this, it has grown larger than ever. I count now 129 participants, and it involves colleagues from schools and universities all over the world. To foster this global sense of community, we have decided that we will continue to run the forum in blended forms so that we can, whenever social distancing is lifted, that is, to maximize participation and exchange. Therefore, keep an eye on the mailing list, subscribe to the mailing list forum to receive the latest updates and participate to the next one, even if only in a virtual form. Now, before I leave the floor to our fantastic speakers today, I have to say that the forum would not be possible without a number of exceptional colleagues whom I want to thank wholeheartedly. First and foremost, Fiona Jones and Lyle Young, our wonderful marketing team, who have managed everything from the website to, of course, live tweeting of the event. And if you just don't fancy staying into the Zoom interface, you can log on to Twitter and follow us at MLUniKent or follow what's happening here at the forum with the hashtag MLTFKent. And of course, I want to thank Mary Daly for having lent us our school's Zoom account with a large meeting add-on. A huge thank you to Vissia Ferrucci, our modern languages coordinator, who has co-organized this event and all the past fora. And Dr. Heide Kunzelmann, our senior tutor, who has kindly volunteered to be our bouncer for the evening. She's manning at the moment Mary Daly's account, and she's the one who's admitting participants. No small thanks, of course, goes to our speakers tonight, whom you will hear very shortly, I promise, and whom I will present in a moment. But also it goes to our wonderful speakers who have delivered their speech for asynchronous delivery. We should get into the jargon of online teaching provision. Antonella Giacosa and Alexis Silvestri with Carla Forero's contribution to follow. You can find them on our website in video and in PowerPoint forms. Therefore, without further ado, I have spoken for way too much time at the moment. It is time that I leave the floor to the first speaker for tonight, Sascha Stollhans, who is a senior teaching associate in German studies at Lancaster University. His academic interests include Germanic and Romance linguistics and second language acquisition, educational policy, as well as language teaching pedagogy. He's been involved in two major projects, the Linguistics in Modern Foreign Language project, a cross-institutional initiative which assesses the potential for inclusion of linguistics in the secondary education Modern Foreign Languages curriculum, and the project funded by the AHRC, Language Acts and World Making Initiative, which explored the transitions and collaborations between different education sectors. And tonight he will be presenting a paper entitled Get Me Out of Here, Designing Online Escape Games for Language Learning. Thank you very much. And Sascha, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much. Hello, everyone. Now, the first big hurdle is to try to get you to be able to see my slides. Now, it currently says that the host disabled my screen sharing, Alvise.
Right. Heide, can you activate, yeah, no worries.
No rush. Ah, now it's working. Okay.
Fantastic.
Now, can you see my slides?
Yes.
Perfect. Brilliant. So thank you very much for inviting me. It's a real honor to be able to speak to you. Now, I'm going to talk about escape games for language learning. And I have to start by admitting that this is something I've only discovered fairly recently myself. So I'm going to share very early experiences with you. But I have been interested in gamification and games in language learning for quite a long time. So, and I think that fits in very well. Now, I've only got about 10 minutes. I'm going to highlight some key aspects for you. So what are escape games and why could they be a good tool for language learning? I'll show you an example of one that I tried myself. And then I'm going to summarize by showing you some steps, some advice for creating escape games yourself. Now, if this was a longer workshop, I would actually start by playing an escape game with you, because I think that's the best way to really find out what escape games are all about and how they work. And it's really good fun as well. So if we had more time, I would play one with you. And I would start by showing you this little video. It's just a minute, so let's watch it.
There's no sound.
I heard someone saying there's no sound. It doesn't really matter. You would have been able to hear a nice little song, but it doesn't really matter that much. So this is sort of like a video that I use when I play escape games in classes or something like that to get people interested and as a motivational introduction. And we could have played the game and I would have sent you a link to a website. And this is something very, very simple that I just created with Google Forms and a few questions. And if you answer those questions correctly, you would have been able to send the password and then you would have solved the mission. Yeah? So this is really a very, very simple, basic way of doing an escape room, a mini escape room, if you like. Okay. Now, what is an escape game or an escape room? For those of you who have never played this before, it's been a hugely popular thing. There are about an estimated 1,500 different escape rooms in the UK currently. There's an international association for escape rooms, and it's basically a free time activity where a group of friends or family go to one of those providers of escape rooms, and then they'll be locked into a room, and they have to solve different missions to be able to break out. So that's why they're sometimes called breakout rooms as well. Now, obviously, if we play escape rooms in our classes, either face-to-face in physical classes or online, we're not going to lock people into a room. That's not what we do. But I think what we can do is we can be guided by this idea that there is a big overall mission, and you have to sort of try to solve that mission and to do lots of different little tasks that help you towards solving this mission. And the other thing is, when you're in an escape room, you don't usually have help. Sometimes the person who owns the room might give you a few tips or some advice, but usually it's completely self-directed. And I think that's really interesting and really exciting for language teaching or teaching in general. Now, I don't really have time to go through some theory with you, but I did want to throw some terms at you, because as a researcher, it's really important to me that what we do is embedded in theory and has some theoretical considerations. So the escape rooms can be analyzed as a method part of gamification, which basically is the use of games, in this case serious games, so games that have not been, or games whose primary purpose is not entertainment, but rather something, yeah, serious, like in this case, education, if you like. I've given you some references here. I'd be happy to share the slides afterwards. So if you're interested in this, you can read more about it. And apart from that, from gamification, really, I think what escape rooms, what escape games really do, and what games generally really do, is they encourage the development of transferable skills like teamwork, creativity, technology skills, problem solving, analytical skills, communication, to name but a few. Okay. Now, to give you a concrete example of something I've done, and I've actually done that in this in a physical class, but it will be fairly straightforward to create something like this in a digital environment, especially at the moment. So what I've done is I've created an escape room based on German modal verbs. Exciting topic. We all love modal verbs, and they are particularly difficult in German because they have lots of idiomatic meanings. So you can use a modal verb to express a speaker's attitude. It works a little bit like a subjunctive in some Romance languages, if you like. It's not a very good linguistic explanation, but just to give you an idea what I mean. So you could say something like, in German, or in English as well, actually, he must be in his room, which doesn't actually mean that he must be there or he has to be there, but it's an assumption, a speaker's assumption. And this is really hard for learners of German to crack. So I've designed an escape room around this. I've given them an overall mission, and that is to find a password. So I didn't lock them in the room. I asked them to find the password. Now, how did they find the password? They found the password by doing different exercises. And you can imagine it a little bit like working, like workstations. Yeah? And I think the difference, the big difference to sort of conventional workstations is that I didn't help them. I stepped back and they had to find out what they had to do, how they needed to do it. They had to think about how they wanted to distribute the work amongst themselves, or if they wanted to split the work, in which order they wanted to do the exercise. It was completely up to them because it was their mission to find the password without any help. And then they did different things like jigsaw puzzles, and they all had to do with these modal verbs. And whenever they completed one of the missions correctly, they would get a hint towards the password. And once they've done all of them, they would be able to use all those hints to work out the password. Now, if you were to do this in a digital environment, you could easily use something like Google Forms, or you put something on a website where you describe the mission and then you give links to the different activities that they are supposed to do. And you can use all sorts of apps, even things like Quizlet, for them to work through. And the important thing is, whatever each of the little activities has to provide a hint for the overall password. And that's the idea behind escape rooms. Okay, I used a similar video at the beginning, like the one I showed you at the beginning, to get them in the mood and to sort of like, yeah, create a bit of an exciting atmosphere. Okay, feedback was very, very positive. What I particularly liked is that students pointed out that it combined language learning with other skills. And when I asked students about that informally after I did this feedback questionnaire, they also said things like, yeah, things like teamwork, and they named transferable skills without actually calling them transferable skills. So that's very encouraging. And I think we shouldn't underestimate that things that are fun and motivational have a big effect as well. Okay, so if I were to create a new one, digitally or physically, these are sort of the steps I imagine would be important. Set the overall mission and goal. So is it finding a password? Is it something else? So whereas in a real escape room, you would have the mission to break out of the room. So what is the equivalent for us? Create a number of activities that help students achieve the goal. Do a bit of a motivational introduction, like a little video like this, which I created very easily in like 10 minutes using PowTune, which is a great program for these things, and it's free. During the game, the tutor should step back and only really intervene if absolutely necessary, because that's part of the game. And there has to be a way to check if the overall mission has been achieved. So what I did, for example, I had a Google form where students had to enter their password. They only had 3 attempts. And if it was correct, the Google form would say, yes, congratulations, correct. If it was wrong, the Google form would say, no, that's not the password we were looking for. And that's very easy to do with Google. Now, if you would like to learn more about escape rooms in language teaching particularly, there's a brilliant podcast. You might know this hashtag, hashtag MFI Twitterati, which is a hashtag that is hosted by Joe Dale. And Joe Dale and Noah Geisel have done a series of podcasts, really, on different topics around language teaching and learning. And there is one entirely dedicated to escape games. It's about an hour or so. And it's brilliant with lots of ideas and lots of teachers, secondary and higher education teachers, talking about their experiences and sharing their resources. So I can really recommend that. Okay, whew, 10 minutes. Thank you very much. I look forward to your questions.
Fantastic. Thank you very much. Of course, we cannot expect the usual round of applause. Thank you very much for staying within the 10 minutes very, very sharply. So do we have any questions? We have Susanna raised.
Yeah, hi. From Susanna. Hi. Yeah, very interesting. I enjoyed learning about this. A question, it may be a naive question, but have you ever experienced using these escape games on a one-to-one basis when you have only one student? And not you?
Yeah, the short answer is no, because I teach at Lancaster University, but we have bigger groups. We don't have just one student. No, I can imagine that it would be difficult because you would lose this aspect of collaborative learning and working as a team to sort of like, so yeah.
But then again, it's a challenge anyhow.
It's a challenge in itself. You're absolutely right. I don't think it would be impossible. It would just be a sort of different approach to it. Yeah.
Yeah, I'll try. Thanks.
Yeah.
I don't see any other raised hand, but I see a lot of questions on the chat. There's a request for the links that you have shown in the PowerPoint, Sasha. If you could link them in the chat, if you don't mind.
Yeah, I could.
We will share also the presentation after the forum. But for now. And Agnes Gower asks, what sort of activities do you ask students to do?
Yeah, that's a good question. So the escape rooms, so the idea behind escape rooms is not really about these sort of activities they do. It's more the bigger picture and the bigger sort of this idea that you have a big mission and they do different things. What I did is I did different activities that I would do in regular classes as well. So things like matching up sentences or the translation with the original German sentence. And then if they match them up correctly, like a jigsaw puzzle, an image would appear and that image would give a hint towards the password. So the activities are fairly like normal activities, if you like, because that's not really the point or the sort of like the idea behind escape rooms. The idea is to use regular activities and put them together in a slightly different way and create this story, this mission around them.
Thank you. We have 3 more questions. I will collate them together if you don't mind.
Yeah, absolutely.
Daniela asks, if you think that this activity can lend itself for online teaching with collaboration among students in breakout rooms. Joe Brown asks, how long would it take in class on average? And finally, Evelise asks in the chat, if there is any alternative to Google Forms.
Mm. Well, yeah, so anything where you have some flexibility, so you could use any website, really. I find Google Forms fairly straightforward because you can give information, you can add links, and you can ask questions at the same time. But you can use anything where you can create something online that you can share. So it could be, you know, if you use Microsoft Teams, it could be a channel on Teams. If you just have a website, institutional website that you could use, so it could be anything like that, really. I see, how long does it take in class? So I usually do mine so as separate units in 1 hour, so in 1 hour of teaching. But you could have bigger projects. I think you could have sort of like ongoing projects where several classes contribute to the overall thing. So it's very flexible. Someone's saying, yes, you can set it up in the VLE. You can use Moodle, of course, and Blackboard. So you basically just need some space where you can add your links and your information. And have I answered all the questions?
Yes, there was Daniela's question, if this activity lends itself for online teaching with collaboration among students in breakout rooms.
Yeah, I think it would. Something like Zoom, for example, where you can have breakout rooms that students can work in, I think would be perfect for it. But also if you use something like Microsoft Teams, again, we use Teams, that's why I know Teams the best. That's why I'm so clumsy here with the technology in Zoom. You can have breakout rooms. You can do it asynchronously. I would assume as well by giving the task and then asking them to organize themselves. They tend to organize themselves via WhatsApp or Facebook groups anyway. So I think that's definitely possible.
Fantastic. We have many, many more questions coming in, but we have also a tight schedule. So if you don't mind, can those who ask this question keep these in mind, and we can go back to Sascha during the discussion at the end of the forum, if you don't
That's
mind.
That's absolutely fine.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much. And we thank you for the inspiration you have given us for creating new new ways of entertaining students, and also teaching them, of course.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thanks.
We have now Sandra Baer, who studied German studies, English studies, and performance studies, an MA with teaching qualification at Friedrich Alexander University in Nuremberg. After her degree, she worked for German studies at the University of Sheffield and at the University of Reading, and is currently working as a DAAD lectorin for German studies at Uppsala University in Sweden. And Sandra will present tonight on screencasts as an example for creative learning methods in times of social distancing. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you very much for the invitation. I'm very excited to be here. That's one of the positive things of this situation, that something like this is possible. I hope you can see my PowerPoint now. Okay, I'm going to do my best to stick to the time limit as well. Just a bit of background information. So at Uppsala University, we also use Zoom for teaching. This is one of some memes my students created. Memes are very popular among my students. So the life goes on Zoom. I was very lucky, or have been very lucky, to have students who are cooperating very well on Zoom and are very open for new methods, digital methods and apps. And I will focus on practical aspects because it's only 10 minutes. I want to show you a screencast project that I have also done before social distancing, but it's very easy to, or it's like an advantage to use it in this situation, and a screencast app that I only found out about a couple of weeks ago, and I'm very excited about the app. So because I recently gave a workshop where people didn't know what a meme is, I think most of you will know what a screencast is, but the definition is it's a video recording, obviously on a screen of a computer, with accompanying audio, and it's often used for tutorials. For example, on YouTube, there are loads of screencast tutorials on a variety of topics. And it's really useful for educational aspects as well, especially for peer teaching. What I have done is a screencast project, which is part of a German cultural studies course in the first semester. My students are post A-level students. This is a content course, but it can be easily used for a language class as well. We just in this course, I don't mark the language. It's mostly about the content. My students have to do this screencast and a written report. It's continuous assessment. And I wanted to have some alternatives to PowerPoint presentations, which are, so most presentations in Sweden before I arrived at my university were only PowerPoint, and I wanted to have something more creative. And especially for this environment, it's easy to share it. Either students can share it on Zoom, or they can also send it to the lecturer if there's a different environment. And it's also nice for marking because it's an alternative to correcting or marking essays. In this case, it's 60% of the mark because it's quite a lot of work to have the screencast and the written report. And we also use nice videos for outreach purposes on our Facebook site. The guidelines for the students are they have to find a topic that is related to either German or Austrian culture. They can decide on their favorite topic, but obviously they have to discuss it with me if it's okay and if it's suitable. Before social distancing, they were allowed to work in pairs. Now I told them they should, and in Sweden it's a bit, I don't know if you know about that, it's a different topic, but it's not as strict. So they could work in pairs, but they can also work on their own. They have a research phase where they are supposed to use authentic German sources to find out about their topic and create a screencast that is about 4 minutes long. The choice of software is free. I suggest usually iMovie, Windows Movie Maker, or VideoPad Video Editor. I would say because most students are in their 20s, they're very familiar with creating videos. I offer them support, but usually they don't need it. And I also tell them that I won't mark technical aspects because it's not a media degree. And if there are some technical problems, they won't get a worse mark. The most important thing for me is that it's informative, but also creative, in order to engage their peers, because we watch the screencasts together, either in class or now on Zoom, and the peers ask questions so that I can find out how much they know about their topic. I will also ask questions. In the report, they reflect about the topic, so why did they want to focus on this topic, and what did they find out, were there surprising results, and how did the creation of the screencast go? I want to show you 1 minute of two different movies or screencasts my students created. One is about the Ampelmännchen, so it will be in German, but it's more about that you see like two different ways of dealing with this. One student used iMovie, the other one focused on Austrian cafes. It's a special thing, Kaffeehäuser, and used the VideoPad Video Editor, and I hope this is working well now to show you this.
Yeah, sure.
Can you see the video now? Can somebody give me some feedback?
No, I'm seeing a file. We're seeing a file explorer.
Okay.
And now nothing.
Thank you. Now?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, we see the video.
In der Aufregung der Stadt sich Zeit genommen hat, mal auf die Ampel hinaufzublicken.
Sorry?
And we hear it too.
Good. Awesome.
Hat vielleicht das Ampelmännchen entdeckt. Seit 1969 leiten die heute weltberühmten Steher- und Geher-Fußgänger über die Straßen Ostberlins. Aber heute ist er nicht nur in der früheren DDR zu erkennen und nicht mal nur in Berlin oder nur in Deutschland. Aber wie genau ist das Männchen aus die Ampel und in die Herzen der Deutschen geklettert? Und was für ein Erbe hat es sich hintergelassen? Der Ostampelmann ist in den früheren 1960er Jahren geboren. Er wurde von dem Verkehrspsychologe Karl Peglau entworfen und das Ziel war, die westliche Figuren gegen mehr.
Okay, so that was the first example.
Willkommen!
And this is the second example.
Willkommen in Wien oder Grüß Gott, wie Sie hier einander grüßen. In dieser Stadt versteckt sich was Besonderes, nämlich die Wiener Kaffeehauskultur. Wenn Sie jemanden fragen würde, was man unbedingt in Wien machen muss, liegt Kaffee sicherlich auf der Liste. Wie ist es so geworden, dass diese Stadt so verliebt in Kaffee ist? Genau das würde ich euch erklären. Erst müssen wir mit der Geschichte anfangen. Mit Abstammung vom Ende des 17. Jahrhunderts und einer Geschichte, dass während der zweiten türkischen Belagerung Wiens fand der König von Polen, Jan Sobieski, einige Sekten.
Okay, so you got an impression of two different examples. I also had a student who, he did a screencast about Tatort, which is a famous German TV show, and he used video, like video footage of Tatort, so there was also a possibility. You can see my PowerPoint again, I hope.
Yes.
Okay. I gave my students also some questions for evaluation, and I was very happy to see the results. So they basically commented on what I was hoping for. So they said, so the German parts are original student feedback, which is why they have mistakes in it. And I translated it for people who don't speak German. So they're happy to, we're happy to create something creative that is also entertaining and informative. They appreciated it that they could choose a topic they're interested in and present it to others. And they also enjoyed the presentations. So they enjoyed the topics because one student also said, you can see it here. It were these were topics they hadn't thought about before. And it was also fun to watch the different types of screencasts and to see in which way the others did their projects. Okay. The other thing I wanted to show you is the screencast. The bad news are that it's only for German and English so far, but maybe somebody knows a similar app like this, because I think it's really cool to, you have a lot of possibilities what you can do with it. It's called My Simple Show, and because we have to stick to the time limit, I'm not gonna explain it in detail, but there are a lot of tutorials how to use it, and it's basically self-explanatory. There are some templates. You can either do a screencast like what I did with my students before, or you can use it for language classes for a variety of topics. For example, a book report or film report, a recipe, applications and other things. And what I did, the example I want to show you focuses on sende Grüße, so send greetings. I asked my students to write a letter to a person who they can't see because of social distancing, a real or fictional person, about 40 words. And in this app, you can either use your own voice or a provided voice. The app is completely free. If you buy the option to buy a more expensive version, there you have different voices, but you don't really need it, I think. They could use the layout provided and then click on Beispiele, examples and send greetings. And I wanted to show you one example of my students. Can you see the website now?
Yes, we can.
Yes.
Right.
Liebe Angelika, sonnige Grüße aus Uppsala, Schweden. Hier kommt der Frühling schnell, auch wenn das Leben sonst etwas langsamer ist als normal. Ich denke gerne an den Frühling in Berlin, auf der Veranda bei dir zu Hause mit einem Weißwein Bitter Lemon. Oder im Garten hinter dem Gemeindehaus nach dem Trödel, Olli mit einem Bier in der Hand und wer nicht Auto fährt mit einem Rotwein. Ihr fehlt mir. Wenn die Corona vorbei ist, sehen wir uns mal wieder. Liebe Grüße, Saga.
Okay, so this is something you can do. There are loads of different things you can do with this app. So it's one of my favorite apps for now. Thank you very much. I hope, I did it in the right time. And if you have any questions, just let me know.
Thank you very much. It was absolutely great. I'll definitely look up this tool also for Italian. I see we have already some raised hands. We have Susanna Florisi who has raised hand, and also a virtual raised hand by Raul Marchena. So should we start with Susanna?
No, sorry, my hand was.
Oh, it was okay.
Yeah, it was absolutely. Even though this was great, thank you.
This doesn't happen in person. One doesn't forget to put their hand back. Usually, it's one of the perks of virtual learning. Raul Marchena.
Hi, Sandra.
Hey.
Nice to see you again. We miss you. Just a quick question. I mean, we have been trying this and I absolutely love it. I think one of the issues that people have raised always is when you do these sort of things and then it's a summative assessment, you know, you are taking the risk that students might be reading what they are like doing the presentation and putting their voice over. So how have you dealt with that? Basically, it's just to know what your experience in terms of that issue.
Yeah, that's a good point, actually. In this, because this course was only about the content and not about language, I didn't have the problem.
Right.
But it is a problem. I have other video projects where I have the same problem, but usually you can only mark what they give you. So, but it's a valid comment.
All right. No, it was just to know your experience about them. Yeah. I mean, students, actually, some of them do genuinely do the presentation without reading as you advise them. But, you know, the odd case.
Yeah.
Okay. Can I just say something there? Because I've been having this discussion and it's not like it solves the issue, but I ask students to submit their script. And therefore, we can see how much they have copied, how much they have quoted. So this is a way to see how much creation has gone into producing the script. So if you have them submitting it, you can see it. So there is a way around the problem. What do you think, Sandra?
Yeah, I'm not sure because you might have the same problem that somebody can help them creating the script. But
oh well, yes, that is that's for sure. But with online tuition, we don't have any control.
I know. Yeah. I mean, from my experience with other projects, it was mostly like 80% doing it themselves or 90%. Like it's two or three students who sound much better than usual. But yeah. It happens, yeah.
Fair enough. Can I conflate a couple of questions that we have on the chat? Christine notes that if you can use your own voice, you can do this in any language, even though the website is in German.
That's right. But I mean, you can use the English templates and use your own voice. Just for German, it's nice because the templates are also in German. But that's right, actually. Yeah.
Fair enough. And Lucy says, this is really great. Thank you, Sandra. I wonder, do you need to give students a lot of instruction about this in advance, or do you leave them a lot of freedom in how they interpret the task? Claire asks, for simple show, do the students pick images that go with their videos, or does it pick out keywords and the videos are automatically generated? And Nalina asks, is it suitable for secondary school students?
Okay, so yeah, that is the nice thing about it, because you can choose, I'm going to the second question first. You can choose your own images. So it's completely, what the video I showed you was completely created by my student. She just got the structure of the task. I think this works well with secondary school students, I would say. Definitely. And the first question.
How much freedom do you leave to your students?
They have quite a bit of freedom. I mean, with the topic, I want them to choose a topic that's not too stereotypical. That's a bit special. And then I would say I give them a lot of freedom. Just, I mean, the examples you've seen, I didn't give them so many instructions. I just really point out that it should be informative and creative, so it's not just, so that it's not boring. I mean, of course, sometimes there are some videos who are a bit less creative and I can't give them a bad mark for that, but it's really nice if they put in effort. And I want them to really also, but to focus on the informative part as well, so it's not just entertaining. But that's mostly what I tell them. And we talk about cultural topics in the course. And I mean, this is after like 5 or 6 sessions of the course. So they already have some help in how to approach cultural topics.
Fantastic. Thank you. Thank you very much, Sandra. Unfortunately, we have to move on in the schedule, but of course, we will return to this during the discussion at the end. Thank you. Thank you very much, Sandra. Now we have a contribution by Laura Stecca, educator for the Department of Linguistics and Comparative Cultural Studies at Ca' Foscari University in Venice. Laura graduated in languages, civilization and language sciences and holds a master in teaching Italian as a second language. She will present tonight on communication and sense of community in the virtual language classroom. Thank you very much. Laura, over to you.
Hello, everyone, and thanks, Alvise, for introducing me. I'm going to share my screen and my presentation. I hope you can now see it. So I'm currently teaching Italian language to Americans, Spanish to Italians, and English to Russians. And if there is one thing each of my students agrees with, is that they prefer face-to-face lessons over online ones. The reason is that they feel they cannot communicate online, neither with the teacher nor, most important, with their classmates. This because the risk of online lessons is for them to become frontal lessons, easier to manage and to organize for teachers. But as we language teachers already know, a frontal transmission of concepts and rules is not only low motivating for our students, but also pretty useless in language learning. Our students need to communicate and to put the language they study into practice as much as possible, working in pairs and in groups and creating a sense of community usually existing in the physical classroom. So we've just seen that these are the main problems of the online lesson. It's often considered a compensatory tool by the teacher who turns the lesson into a frontal one. And the students cannot really communicate among themselves, or they cannot do it with the monitoring of the teacher. For example, through the breakout rooms option here on Zoom. And of course, if we do not use the breakout rooms option, only one person can speak at a time. The first solution I can suggest you is to create a group on a social media. You can decide the one you prefer. This allows you to create a post and set the rules for positive online communication and interaction, because of course the rules of online communication are not the same as the face-to-face one. Then it motivates students, mostly if they're young, because it's a way to enter their world. And through a group, everyone has everyone's contact. And we will see why this is important for us. Last, through a social network, it is possible to share the outcomes of the activities with the entire group, with the entire class, which is what we would usually do, hanging posters on the wall of our classroom. I'm going to show you two activities I have experimented with a group of Russian girls aged 15 who attend a B1 level English course in Babylon, a language center based in the tiny smiling town of Ludinova. I worked there 3 years ago and I still cooperate with the school in remote mode. I decided to experiment with them, being English a neutral language for us today, but of course you can use the activity in every other modern language. The first activity is an oral comprehension, the description of a painting to a partner. Each student receives the photo of a painting through an individual chat. I have chosen these two you see on the slide, one by Chagall and the other one by Van Gogh. One student describes the painting to the partner, who needs to draw it on a piece of paper. The partner can ask questions in case they are not sure they have understood. And listening to the recordings, the most popular question was on Chagall's painting, and it was, is the man flying? Like, really flying? And once the description is finished, both the drawing and the painting are shown to the partners, to each other. The most important aspect is that through the drawings, the teacher can see problems in vocabulary and comprehension. I think the activity is particularly good for vocabulary, especially for our revision of it. But if you use paintings with words, with objects, students whose names students don't know, you can also notice the strive for communication of the students and the strategies they use to describe the objects. And I'm going to show you two examples of this.
There is a place where we can put our clothes.
Mm-hmm.
Not put, hang.
Of course, the place where we hang clothes is a robe hanger. And the second one?
So next to the table, we can see a chair. It is white, but it has a black pillow. It is round.
And a round chair is a stool. On this slide, you can see some of the outcomes, some of the drawings by the students. So we have seen that it is possible for students to work in pairs online, but how to make it work, how to make it possible with the entire class? Let's say we have lessons on Zoom and that we created a group on Facebook. We're going to explain the task during the lesson on Zoom, set the time to complete the task saying to the students, for example, you have 7 minutes to complete the task, set the time on your personal devices. We're going to divide, of course, the class into groups or pairs. We're going to tell the students to turn their volume down on Zoom and have them video call the partners using their mobile phones and earphones through Facebook, so through a messenger video call. In this way, we can monitor them by watching them on Zoom. And in case they have questions of any kind or any kind of problems, they can just turn their volume up and ask you. After the 7 minutes, everybody is back on Zoom again. We can ask some groups to show the outcomes of the activity. And of course, we can then share all the outcomes on the Facebook group. The second activity I'm going to show you was so much fun to do with the girls. Since during the lockdown, many people, but teachers, I would say, had time to relax and learn how to do new things, I asked them to create a video tutorial each, teaching their classmates how to do something they can do well. The results have been shared on our group on the social network. So, for example, they decided to build a fort to watch Netflix. Or to cook something.
Let's make Viennese waffles.
We should add a cup milk, 2 teaspoons sugar, 1 egg, 2 tablespoons oil, and some salt, and make it smooth. Then we should chop a banana and add it in our butter.
Or to teach us how to use watercolors. This is useful not only to improve their language skills, but also to let them talk and comment each other's videos and to create that sense of community we were trying to achieve online. And even if you are the teacher, you can learn something new. For example, how to make some amazing banana pancakes. Thanks for your attention.
Fantastic. Thank you very much, Laura. That was 10 minutes perfect. We already have a question that was asked during the presentation, so I will move to that question now. Ruth asks, create a group on a social network. Is this really something you as a teacher should encourage, and are you part of a group?
I encourage the use of social networks because we can communicate in the language the students study, also outside the class and outside the lesson, and we can share anything, links or memes or whatever students can find in the language.
Thank you. And Pauline picks up on this question and says that, many thanks, Laura. Sharing everyone's contact is a nice idea in principle, but in practice can be problematic as some students may not want to share contact details to other students for whichever reason. Students uncomfortable with the idea may feel singled out if they refuse. Have you thought of ways to prevent this issue?
I'm usually really very clear with the students. We use their contacts to use the language, and I've never had these kind of problems with my students, but I can understand that it can be an issue. I think they can maybe use some other Zoom or Meet, Google Meet or whatever. Other programs to make video calls.
Thank you. And then we have two more questions. Claire asks, what about using Blackboard? Would students be far less inclined to use it than Instagram, for example? And Caroline asks, so as a teacher, you are not able to listen in on the conversation that is happening in the breakout groups. Is that right?
So you can use also Blackboard. I think that using a social network, students usually use every day would be more motivating for them, but you can use also others ways. And the second question was?
The second question was if you can, if you are not able to listen in on the conversation that is happening in the breakout groups.
No, but if we use Zoom and their mobile phones, for example, I will be able to listen to them.
Okay. Elizabeth notes that data protection, GDPR, might be a problem in this case. And Rosa asks you, once you have set up the task and they are communicating, you say they should stay in Zoom. Can you say a bit more about this?
Yes, they should stay in Zoom. The microphones in Zoom will not be muted, so the teacher can listen to them and can see them. But of course, the students will not disturb each other because they will use earphones.
Fantastic, thank you. And then we have a question from Christine. In Blackboard Collaborate, you can create groups and you can listen in as a teacher. So that may be a solution?
Of course, I've never used Blackboard, but this can be an amazing solution.
Fair enough. Fantastic, thank you. Thank you very much. Do we have any further questions for Laura? Laura, that was great. Thank you very much. And I am very much looking forward to start applying these in my classes. I think the idea of asking students to create tutorials, although it might be problematic because you never know what they know how to do and if they maybe there is something you might not want to learn about them, but still, I think it's very, very entertaining. So thank you very much. We have now Alice Gasparini, who is a PhD candidate in second language acquisition at the University Gabriele D'Annunzio in Pescara, and has a long experience as a teacher of Italian as a second language in Russia, Spain and Italy. And tonight Alice will be presenting on Scorci Italiani, a learning environment for Italian as a secondary language. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Alvise. Thank you everybody for the opportunity to share my course. So I will share the presentation too, if everything is fine. Okay, do you see it?
Yes.
Okay, so I will present this course I created for my PhD project. It is part of my PhD project, actually. And I will start briefly with my PhD project. And I can't go on with the presentation. That's not good. Okay, so let me start with a small story to explain my PhD project. You know the story about Goldilocks and the three bears? So Goldilocks enters into the three bears' house and she wants to sit on a chair. She tries the first one, but it's too big. The second one is too hard. And the third one, it's just perfect for her. So that's my PhD project about, more or less. So let's try to replace Goldilocks with the students of Italian second language. And the chairs are the learning environment. So I try to understand what is the best learning environment, the easiest, the most usable,
the most convenient for students who want to learn Italian as a second language. So this is what my PhD project is about. So the usability, so how to find the best, as I said, learning environment. I compare two learning environments where I created this Italian course, online course, Scorci Italiani, and that I will talk about later, and in Moodle and in WordPress. So two very different learning environments for students of Italian as second language. Now, let's go back. Let's go to the straight to the course. I will present today only the WordPress version because we don't have much time for both. So I needed a learning environment, so WordPress website, and I used for my linguistic activities, I used this plugin that you see, H5P, to create interactive contents. So the course I created is called Scorci Italiani, in English means Italian glimpses. Is for Italian as a second language student, as I said, A2, B1 level. And it's for mainly self-study. So they use the alone without a teacher. But I also experimented it in my classroom before the lockdown, Erasmus students mainly. And so it can be used also in traditional, we can say, teaching environment. This course focuses on places, because places are are very relevant from a communication point of view. They are full of, we can say, language, society, and culture. So I took five relevant places for students or workers who come here to work. So the target students are mainly university students and workers. And I picked up the coffee shop, which in Italian is a quite important, relevant place, office, the doctor, house, and then university. So that's why I said that it's for both students and university students and workers. And then we have like a bonus track, we can say, a bonus unit, which is songs, and it's grammar review activities. So the students listen to the songs and they have like activities to review grammar. Now, this is the homepage of my website. And you can see that you have five units. And each unit includes six sections. And the section have a different focus. So communication, lexicon, grammar, culture, and the last one is communicative output. And then you see at the bottom canzoni, which is songs. Now, I present briefly three activities which focus on listening comprehension of the student. So the first one is an interactive video. The second one is just an audio with some multiple choice. And the last one is a song. So this is an interactive video. You see the dots on the timeline, and the dots show that the student will find question on this time, we can say. So the video stops and the student answer the question. I would like to show you now briefly what this is. This is a trailer of an Italian movie. I hope that you can hear it. Okay. And then you find here the questions. The students receive immediate feedback and then they go on. And that's the thing. Okay. The next one. Sorry. Okay. I wanted to say that you can embed a very different, a big range of linguistic activities. For example, we said a multiple choice, and here you see a fill in the blank. So the video stops, and the student can immediate make the activity. So next one is an audio. So you have the player, and then the multiple choice questions. And this is it. Okay. Okay, and that was the audio with the multiple choice. And then the last one, it's the song. You see the video of the song. This is a song by Jovanotti, and it's the purpose is reviewing the passato prossimo, so a past tense in Italian. And you have the video here. Oops, sorry. Nope. I don't know why. I can't. Okay.
Lingua parli tu, se dico vita dimmi cosa intendi, e come vivi tu, se dico forza attacchio ti difendi.
Okay. And you see here the fill in the blank and the check option. Okay, and I think this is it. I think I was very quick, and these are my contact details if you need any, I don't know, advice, or you want to know something more about the way to build a course like this. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. It is a very, very, it is a complex website. Very interesting how you put that together. So we have a first question from the chat. Sandra asks, what did you use to create the interactive video? And I can see that there is also an answer.
H5P. It's a plugin that you find free. It's free in WordPress. In every WordPress website, you just add a plugin and it's free.
Okay,
perfect. It offers a range, a very wide range of linguistic interactive content, as they called, and you build with your activities in any language.
And that's fantastic. So it's based on WordPress, the website. Okay.
Yes, but it's a plugin that you can find in many other platforms. So in my Moodle version, you can add also in Moodle, and I think also in Blackboard and in other platform as a third party's plugin, just like this.
Fantastic. Thank you. Thank you very much. We have another question from the chat, and I also share this this question, and others do. Thank you very much, Alice says Mano, and he asks, how did you manage to with the copyright of videos and music videos? And that would be also my question, and
it's a good question. I didn't I just took it, yes, but yes, for my the audio, they were mine, but the video, I just took it. Yes, I know it's not.
Well, and we've all done it, I think. And this is being recorded, so it's not a safe space. We cannot say that officially that we have all done it, but yeah, we cannot use it officially, at least in our university's platforms, if we don't have copyright clearance. So that might complicate things.
Yes, you can just simply put the audio of the song, maybe that it's yours, so, and without a video, because the other videos are you can the first one, the it's a trailer, so you can find it. And I used a very short part of movie, so very short part of movies that you can find, and they are free.
Elizabeth asks, the copyright issue is more pressing if it is open access. Can you lock WordPress?
Yes. Yes, you can. I locked it. It's locked. You have to register. You simply need to add a plugin. I use the Ultimate member. Yes.
Thank you. And Ruth asks, comments, isn't it problematic to model to students that plagiarism / copyright breach?
It's an issue. Yes, it's an issue that I have to solve. Yes.
Okay. Yeah, it's always a very silver lining with using materials for educational purposes.
But you can also put just the link to the YouTube video.
Yeah, and there is a lot of copyright free stuff and Creative Commons licenses that can be used, I guess, instead. There is just a comment. There is a website called Lyrics Trainer that actually has a lot of of exercises on.
I know.
And that might help solving the copyright the copyright issue, because they.
Yes, I don't know if you can put it inside the website, because
no,
the
probably not. You have to link it. Yeah. Okay. Well, thank you. Thank you very much. Do we have any further question for Alicia? Wait just a second. Okay, I think. Well, thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Alicia. And we look forward to seeing your the PowerPoint, and we will put the links also to your project on the Modern Foreign Languages website. Thank you.
Okay.
And now we have our last contribution for today. Enzo Petit and Olivia Bourne, engineering students, respectively at CentraleSupélec and Cambridge University, who will be discussing the outcomes of a telecollaboration project between the two universities, which began 2 years ago. Their contribution is entitled Telecollaboration Class Immersion into Language Through a Screen. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Alvise. So I'm just going to introduce, and you'll see Enzo in a few minutes, but I will initially share my screen if possible. Okay, so can everyone see that? Yeah, cool.
Yes, yes.
Sorry, thank you. I forget there's no audio, so it's just like visual. thank you very much, Alvise. Enzo and I are two engineering students, like you said, who've been taking part and actually are continuing to take part in this telecollaboration project. It's between Cambridge University Engineering Department and CentraleSupélec, the French engineering school. And we are two of about 15 students per class who've been taking part in this project. It was started 2 years ago, and it was actually set up by our two teachers, Julie and David, who are also on the forum, who set it up to encourage Cambridge students to take part in a year abroad at CentraleSupélec, but also to allow students to benefit from speaking to native speakers of the same age and in smaller groups. So a varying way of teaching compared to a normal classroom environment. The way it worked was we had 1 hour per week on the telecollaboration project, and we used Zoom. So we used the breakout rooms function to get into these smaller groups of three or four to discuss various topics and introduce ourselves each week, because we met new groups obviously each week and we varied it up. And that actually relied on students bringing screens, so laptops and phones, into class to make sure that we had enough screens for this function. And actually, now that we've been in lockdown, obviously everyone's at home using their own screens, but we're still using that breakout rooms function. And we'd always speak in one language to start with, and then we'd switch to the other language to make sure we're not only improving our speaking skills, but honing in on the target language and seeing what it should sound like all at the same time. So now I'm going to do the SWOT analysis that the CentraleSupélec students came up with in their classes. And just a note to say that we're not going to talk about everything on the slides, so there's some extra points that we're not going to go into detail about, it's just for reference.
Okay, thank you. Now that Olivia told you how our telecollaboration classes work, I'm now going to tell you the strength of the project and how it is valuable for students like us. So first of all, we believe that it is easier to speak in pairs with native speakers, especially from the same age. We speak differently than the way teachers speak. We have different accents. I worked with international students studying in Cambridge, and not only British students. So it was quite interesting to see these different aspects of the language. Well, then, thanks to this project, we improved our confidence in the target language. Some students might be afraid to talk in front of a teacher or among a large group of people. And then, thanks to it, they do not fear that they make mistakes, or they do not fear to ask for words. So as I say, the final goal of the project is being fluent in speaking. So we have done some exercises, for instance, describing drawings to our partners, as Laura students did. And so now we feel more confident to speak longer. And of course, we learned a lot of vocabulary. So finally, we also learned culturally through this project. We learned a lot about the news, about what is going on in the country. Well, I remember a talk with two students in which I explained them the French pension reform. And then they talked to me about, for example, Extinction Rebellion activities in the UK. So now, what about the weaknesses? So it was quite difficult to find them. Well, we had some internet problems because some students didn't have a good connection, and especially audio problems because all Cambridge students were in the same room, so it was not quite convenient. And about the lack of written English, well, it was in the French side. Some students might fear that written works were missing, although in the British side, they could combine a telecollaboration class and another class with David, in which they could improve their written skills. So, Olivia.
Perfect. So, I'm going to just move forward with the opportunities that we think this project has. So, obviously, we think it's really worthwhile, as Enzo's explained. And going forward, we would actually love to see it expanded, whether that is across departments or even across abilities. So in Cambridge, it was between the advanced French class and the French students, but that could easily be expanded to an upper intermediate French class And we'd also, it'd be great if it could be expanded across universities. We'd really encourage language teachers to try and make contact with other universities and see if they can set something similar up and form that same connection. It's particularly great in a lockdown environment where it's easy, obviously, to not pay attention to your teacher. If you've got a lesson with one teacher, 15 students, not participate, go on your phone without the teacher knowing. And so breaking up into these smaller rooms with peers is much more engaging, but also more motivational, because you want to, you know, impress them or to try hard, and it just works a lot better. We also think there are a few improvements that we could see with the project. So it would be a great idea to choose your own topics. We did a lot of speaking about set topics, and it would be a great idea to actually choose a relevant topic to your subject, for example, engineering. But then you'd have more to speak about, you'd be much more interested in it and therefore gain more from it. And also increase the range of activities. So like I said, we did a lot of speaking tasks where we were just discussing things, but having presentations, debates, like Enzo mentioned, describing a picture or a technical drawing, also like Laura mentioned, would be other ways of increasing engagement. The main thing though that we think would be really beneficial is continuing outside the classroom. So whether that's set times during lockdown, or as we had an hour a week on this telecollaboration project in class, setting group work between the French and the English students outside the classroom that they're not only interested in, but they then work on together, is great, because it means that you continue that and you're more likely to continue that friendship into the future, that bond. And so it's not just something that you do in class, it actually could be like you could make a pen pal, or like a French exchange situation, make like a connection for life, so that you're more likely to meet in person. It also actually solves the problem, this is in the threats, of the mismatch of calendars, because Cambridge University has very short terms, they're only 8 weeks long. And so the French students actually had some time where we weren't available. And so it's highly beneficial to keep that going out throughout the classroom and throughout the holidays, so that you've not got this period where the telecollaboration isn't happening.
So to conclude, even if we know that it will be hard to set up this type of class, because first you need a certain language level to benefit from these type of classes, and secondly, because you need to convince other teachers to do what our teachers David and Jolie actually created. So we hope that this kind of forum allows more people and people to discover our learning tool and introduce it in their own universities, and of course in other languages. So thank you for listening, and we are now open to any question or remarks. Our teachers are also here if you have any questions for them. Thank you.
Fantastic, thank you. Thank you very much, Olivia and Enzo. That was a really inspiring contribution, and I have already a number of questions that have piled up while you were talking. So I'm going to read them aloud. There is a question that I don't think is relevant for the discussion. Maybe we leave it for later. So I'll start with John's question, who says, "What a fantastic idea to promote both STEM and languages. Well done. To what extent does engineering and specific language for special purposes, here engineering, play a role in these language telecollaboration exchanges?" This is a question I would share. I would like to know the reply to this.
I'm just sort of taking in the question, sorry. So in these classes, it was actually very engineering specific. We were learning about engineering topics the whole lesson. Although we were, as Cambridge students, the second half was writing and grammar exercises. All of the telecollaboration, other than learning about the French education system on occasion, was to do with engineering. So the group projects we set up and that we took part in were engineering topics. We learned about renewable and nuclear energy in the other language. I learned about some electric vehicles. All the content was relevant to engineering.
Thank you. Sean asks, Olivia, do you think it is better to work in pairs or in groups of 3/4?
I actually enjoyed working in 3 or 4. I can see how if you've got one more confident speaker, it sometimes can be a problem because they will then dominate the conversation. And so it's not an equal share. Whereas obviously when you're in pairs, you've both got to speak. But especially starting off, I was less confident to speak in the language. And having someone else there to help me if I was struggling was just nice to have, rather than it being one-on-one and sometimes not knowing what to say. It keeps the conversation going, helps with the flow, and just helps build confidence in those initial stages. I think once you've then set up that connection and you know the students a bit better, then one-on-one works well.
I really like to work, especially in pairs, but I think it depends on the situation, but it's great to work in group of 3 or 4 because you can help the French student, for example, if he cannot explain something about the news in France, so you can support him something. It depends on the situation, but it's better to work in pairs.
Thank you. We have a number of congratulations and compliments here. And then Visya asks, were students asked to write reports on the sessions, or would you ask them to write reports on the sessions if they were to run in the students' spare time?
I'm not sure if that's something also for Julie and David to comment on, but we didn't write reports as such. But we gave feedback to our teachers, so we discussed what we thought was good, what we thought could be improved. We obviously, the CS students came up with the SWOT analysis and discussed it in detail in class, but we never wrote anything at length about it. No.
Thank you. And Sandra asks, how did you start the contact? Did you pair students? Did you pair up? How did
maybe they, David could answer it.
Yeah, maybe I could come in at this stage. Thanks, Olivia and Enzo. You did a great job there. So Julie and I, we've met because obviously Cambridge and CentraleSupélec have some connections, and that's how we started the project. So that's how we paired the two classes, and then inside the class, how we paired students. It was, if that's the meaning of the question, we just every week we would try to allocate different students to. So that they actually get to know different people, they hear different accents, and they get exposed to a wide range of different input. Is that the meaning of the question?
I think so. Yes.
Yeah. Okay.
Or unless Sandra wants further comments.
Yes. Okay. I think she said yes.
Sorry, I'm just scrolling down the Zoom chat, so I'm still seeing. Well, Steve says that at UPS we set up a multi-institution peer-run language facility called Agora, and says to write him in case you want to have further information about it. A lot of thank you and compliments. And Paul asks if this is based on virtual exchange or if it is similar to virtual exchange.
I don't know, David. Yeah.
Yeah. Again, I'm not so sure what the yeah. Okay. Thanks, Belinda, for clarifying. No, we didn't make a connection through the virtual exchange platform. That's the meaning of the question. But I think it's basically the same. The same idea, you know, it's just pairing people up from different institutions. I mean, the main motivation for us was just to drive an interest in the Erasmus year abroad that the students could take part in, essentially.
Yeah, fair enough. Fantastic. Thank you very much. There is a link to the platform that was used to find partners, unicollaboration.org, and you can find it in the chat. Fantastic. Well, wonderful. Thank you. Thank you very much for presenting your telecollaboration project. And we have one more. Elizabeth asks, are the students participating on bilingual programs?
So as part of my degree, there's an option to learn a language alongside it, but it's just an extra and it's an optional. And it's included in my degree paper, so what we call a transcript, transcript across the board, but I'm not sure. So that was just purely by choice. It's not compulsory at all. I'm not doing a bilingual course, but I'd love to if I could.
Students, can I just say
something? Yeah, yeah.
Engineering students in France all have to learn English. It's compulsory. It's part of their program. And a second language. So anyone in STEM is also learning languages.
Thank you.
Although it's not a bilingual program. Well, we do have some bilingual programs, but this is specifically because it's a long tradition that scientists and engineers do foreign languages in France.
Fantastic. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you all for the great contribution about the telecollaboration, and to all the speakers for the very, very inspiring and informative papers and contributions that you gave. Now we have a lot of new tools to use and think about in our online language delivery classes. So thank you very much. I think we have now plenty of time. Well, we have 20 minutes. It's not really plenty of time, but let's see how we go about this to open up the floor for discussion. If you have pending question for our speakers, please feel free to ask them. If the speakers want to add anything, or if anyone really wants to add anything, or comment even on our asynchronous delivery papers, which were made available online earlier today. Okay, in fact, Joe Brown asks, what about asynchronous presentations, how to access them? I will just grab the link to the teaching forum and Thank you, Nalina. Bye. Yes, the links can be printed in a Word doc. Yes, I not from this chat. I fear not from this chat. I think you can copy and paste it from a Word file, but my aim would be to gather everything that's been said here and put it in the Modern Languages Forum website, and then I will circulate it on the mailing list so that everybody is kept up to date. And oh yes, and the host Mary Daly / Heide Kunzelmann says that she can actually save the chat in a file at the end, so we can get all the links from it. No, Carla Forero's presentation is not yet accessible. She will send it at a later date. We will circulate again a notification on the mailing list when that becomes available. Thank you. I have one new message. Okay, nobody with raised hands. The other thing that Visa reminds us is, of course, this forum. The idea of this forum is that we can all contribute. So we are very happy to accept suggestions for the topic of the next forum, which will take place in the autumn term. And regardless of whether social distancing will be still enforced or not, it will take the form of a blended delivery form, so everybody will be able to participate wherever they are in the world. So very happy to accept any suggestions. This is not a raised hand, but a thumbs up. Or Catherine, do you want to say something? No, it was just a thumbs up. Thank you, Steve. Just a thumbs up. If no one has any further questions or comments to add, may I ask everyone really what can you identify as the main challenges that you are facing in having to deliver modern languages teaching online through social distancing, and how we can all contribute? What sort of instruments can we create to make it easier for everyone?
Can I?
Yeah, absolutely.
Motivation, engagement of the students, and that's why I think that every teacher tries to find new tools, because it's you don't see them actually, and they don't see you, or maybe they see, but you are like remote, so that's the difficult part as far as I'm concerned. So yeah, that's why we try.
So it's the contact. Sandrine says lack of community spirit.
Yes, I think that it's even more difficult to attract their attention and to keep the motivation high.
Yeah.
It's more difficult for them to, the lack of interest is more.
The lack of interest emerges more and it demotivates students. Yes, I can see a comment that someone dropped language at a private American university where it was an extra and switched to Duolingo. And there is also a comment about machine translation. So on the one hand, indeed, we face a problem. I guess it refers to plagiarism. We face a problem with plagiarism, and it's been discussed that it's very complicated to understand how much help students got while working online. But at the same time, we risk by removing the human element, at least this seems to be suggested by what Claire says about the students dropping out of German, that what we face is by removing the human element, we remove the added value from language tuition, and this is something I think we should work on
Yes, I just wanted to add that, yes, indeed, creating this interaction, not only on a one-to-one or between two students, but having really the group to work together and interact with each other and discover each other, because being a student in a classroom is also a matter of socializing. And this for me is the most frustrating with this medium, the fact that the students are not really able. Technology doesn't really allow so many people to have their camera and microphones switched on at the same time. We used Collaborate at Aston Uni, and Collaborate is okay, but when we are more than six people communicating, I mean, having the microphone and the camera on at the same time, it's getting challenging.
Yeah.
Well,
yeah, fair enough.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Yes, and I see further comments about changing our approach to make sure students do learn. It's a matter indeed of adjusting as much as possible to the new environment. And indeed, as Alexis points out, we can also try to incorporate sites such as Duolingo in our teaching and show hereby students where its limits are. Yes, indeed. We do that sometimes with Google Translate, showing the sort of issues that can emerge when using just Google Translate or just automatic ways of translation and writing. And Catherine suggests, I will copy this into a different file, a session on assessment dealing with plagiarism and alternative formats of testing. I think a session such as this one would be absolutely great, especially if we have to continue online provision in the autumn term, which is very much likely. So yeah, assessment and alternative formats of testing in this new environment would be absolutely great. Yeah, and I agree also with Claudia's comment that the danger is to try to use too many tools that take up a lot of our time and lose our actual learning objectives. So yeah, that's it is always, I guess, a matter of striking the right balance. I was about to suggest actually that UCML, the University Council for Modern Languages, has created a very good aggregation website, which I linked under the resources and on the forum website. I'm just fishing it out, and I'll link it here. This is a very good. It aggregates a lot of online resources that are shared amongst colleagues at mostly at higher education in this case to teach languages online. But I was suggesting that as part of the forum, it would be great, I think, to create a Google Docs, a collaborative Google Docs, where we can just all chip in and drop the websites that we use, of course, with the cautionary, with the disclaimer that we shouldn't lose ourselves too much in diversifying too much the use of tools and learn losing our objectives, learning objectives. But of course, having a place where we can just put ideas in so that we can all access it. I will set it up. And I will set it up and circulate it at the modern languages at the forum with the forum mailing list. Okay, I will do that in the next couple of days, and then we can all contribute as much as we feel like it. Thank you. Do you have any further comments or ideas? Does someone want to say something? I think. Otherwise, if no one else is taking up the floor, I think it is a good moment to wrap things up. After all, we didn't have a coffee break, we didn't provide nibbles, we didn't offer even a toilet break. So I think it is fair to say that we've been in front of a computer screen nonstop for almost 2 hours. And possibly a little bit longer. So I think we can actually thank everyone, especially our wonderful speakers, which have given us, at least certainly have given me, wonderful, wonderful ideas. I thank everyone for being here. It was absolutely great and stunning participation. And I think the important thing to remember is that the forum doesn't stop here. We have these events that are becoming bigger and bigger, but the forum is a structure, is a network that remains in place, and we can use the mailing list. You can all use the mailing list to communicate with each other. I will circulate there all the materials from the forum. So let me just send you a link to the mailing list so that you subscribe. We don't send a lot of messages, so don't worry, it's not spam.
Alvise, could I just say something?
Yes, by all means.
Yes, it's Steve. Could I ask everybody just to wait before we go to put their mics on and sort of just make a lot of noise for Alvise and the whole team organizing this. So I joined late, about an hour into the thing, but It's a fantastic idea. I thought it was absolutely brilliant, the hour that I saw. So just everybody put their mics on and clap your hands, bang a saucepan, sort of, do whatever you like to make noise for the organising team.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. It was great.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, guys.
Very well done. Merci beaucoup.
Merci.
Thank you.
Grazie.
À la prochaine.
À la prochaine.
Shukran.
Bye-bye. Thank you.
Bye.